the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child and forever I am redeemed. His child and forever I am redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of his presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed. Redeemed, his child and forever I am. Last verse. I know I shall see in his beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed. Isn't that a great word? Good song too, yes. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Irwin, would you word our prayer, please?
Father, I thank you we can stand and say that we have been redeemed by the blood of our Savior Jesus. Mm-hmm. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you give us. Lord, we thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. Father, without those, we're nothing.
That's right.
God, we thank you for this night that brought us together again in your house. Lord, we might receive the word that the pastor has for us. It might apply to our lives, Father. It might go out and be a light into this world.
Amen.
We thank you, God, for all that you've done, all that you're going to do. We ask this in Jesus' sweet and precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Be seated.
Am I up?
Yep.
Okay. Well, let me get my sound turned on, if it'll come on. I'm on. We on the air, ladies and gentlemen. Well, it is good to have you here this evening here at Bible Baptist Church, and we gather every Wednesday night. Doors are open. We are inviting you, if you're out there and watching us on the YouTube, come on by and join us, and we'd appreciate seeing you, and we'll preach to you, and God will bless your heart with the Word. So we are open, and we're getting more open every day. Amen. Texas is opening up, I think they said, the 8th of this March, when the mask will become optional. And what have you. We're giving a lot of vaccine shots. I mean, you know, this thing going nuts.
Amen.
But we're still loving the Lord. So turn with me tonight to the book of Matthew. You know, over these last few weeks, and I don't know how long, I'd have to go back and look, but we don't get in a hurry here too often in the Scriptures. We take our time. But we're studying in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. We did not do chapter 5 because in chapter 5 we find the Beatitudes, which reflect the very personage of Jesus Christ. And as we import those spiritual characteristics into our life, we actually are putting on the mind of Jesus Christ. Amen. But we began in Matthew chapter 6 in verses 1, whereby the Lord begins to teach those the multitude that was there how they should behave themselves and how they should walk uprightly in the world that they inhabit. Now listen to me, folks. The world has changed since Jesus taught Matthew 5, 6, and 7. But the Word of God has not changed. And the obedience of the believer to that Word to walk uprightly and glorify God in the world has not changed at all. And I heard somebody say, well, no, but it's a lot harder to do today. No, it's not. Amen. Every generation must deal with the requirement of walking upright before God. And every generation has its positives and negatives. And one generation is not more of a difficult walk than another generation. We each and every one. None of us have been put in an arena where there are lions and where there are people killing you. So, you know, I'm just saying. So we had began with this portion in Matthew 6, as we said, and we remember that within this, as the Lord is teaching, there's a choice to be made. You recall back in Matthew 6, it talks about the three positive things that a believer will import into his life and walk, therefore, in the Spirit of God and walk in the fellowship of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 says, walk not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. So there's a choice to be made. And we found that that choice was that we would walk in the compassion of Jesus, having great love toward those who are of lesser ability than us. And the Bible says, as you give your alms. And then the Bible tells us that we ought to be involved daily, as the Bible says, pray without ceasing, that we ought to be involved with prayer. But not just any prayer, but prayer that's structured properly, that it glorifies God and becomes a sweet savor in heaven. The Lord gives us the model prayer whereby we can learn and be taught how to approach the Lord, how to approach the throne of God with proper reverence, I guess we'll say. Amen. And then we found that we ought to also be involved with fasting, where that we by fasting can separate ourselves as men of this in this time unto God and grow in the grace of God and be dedicated to Him, putting away the physical aspects of life for a period of time, whereby that we become spiritually stronger. Amen. Amen? But then He also does not just stop there, because for every positive, there's a negative. Amen? Every coin that has a head has a tail. Whatever you put on it to mark it, it has two sides. I saw one a coin once that was a buffalo nickel. Somebody had printed it somewhere or another, and on one side it had the buffalo's head, on the other side it had his tail. Every coin has two sides. Amen. And so when we get over to Matthew chapter 6, where we've been studying, we had started in verses 19, where he starts talking about those negative things, those things of the world that will draw us away from walking with God, walking in the flesh, those things that are dangerous. And we've already studied the first one, that being materialism, where our attitude turns not to the things of God, but to the things of the world. Amen. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Amen. Not the world, but the kingdom of God. And so when we become materialistic, our attitude is drawn away from God. Our dependence is taken away from God. And we become, our next point, self-sufficient. Amen. We lean on self. We hear things in our time. I did when I was a kid anyway. I don't know what the young people say today, how that, we don't need anybody. We can handle it ourselves. We've drawn ourselves up by our own bootstrings. And we take credit for who and what we are in our life when the Bible says we can't even tell you what tomorrow is going to bring. Amen? And so that materialism becomes a curse unto the believer. Now understand, we're talking to believers here. He that does not know God always focuses on the materialistic because he has nothing else to focus on. But we have something. We have the Lord. And so we had studied about materialism, and that materialism brings us to self-sufficiency, which brings us down to Matthew chapter 6, verses 25. And so we're going to read just two verses tonight, Matthew 25 and 26. This portion of Scripture, this self-sufficiency, is going to take us all the way through to the end of chapter 6, but not quickly. It'll take tonight and probably next week, maybe. So stand with me. We're just going to take those two verses and we're going to deal with them as much as we can. The Bible says in verse 25 of Matthew 6, "Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on it. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they?" Amen. You may be seated. When the believer turns to the flesh, releases the master of the Spirit of God and the person of God, and clings to the master of the flesh, which, by the way, we still dwell in a fleshly body, so it has a leg up. Amen. He often or quickly becomes less than spiritual in his appearance. He no longer is walking in an open testimony of fellowship with God. He no longer is feeding the spiritual man, and there's an evidence of spiritual aura with him as he prays and as he gives and as he fasts, and his attention's fixed upon the Lord Jesus Christ and His kingdom. Amen. And as soon as we allow materialism in, we begin to change. And it is not long till materialism has to, by its very nature, draw us to a self-sufficient position. For we're not dependent on God. For God says that He will lead us in spiritual matters before earthly matters. Amen? And so that we become very self-sufficient. Amen? And there's a danger in that, being self-sufficient. When a believer walks in materialism, he becomes self-sufficient, and he then becomes his own authority. Amen? About what's good and what's bad, about what's right and what's wrong. He steers away from the Word of God, for the Word of God to a believer brings great conviction because the Spirit of God still dwells in him. So a believer that is materialistic in his attitudes, in his presentation, he appears as a carnal man, that is a saved man that looks like a world, like a lost man, looks like a worldly man. He will have great conflict in his life. There will be no peace in his life because he is turned away from that natural or that second birth of salvation that was brought in him. Amen? When we walk in that self-sufficiency, he'll find a very complicated situation in his life because he's neither spiritual in the flesh nor fleshly while he walks in the flesh. He's still God's child. So it's a complication, isn't it? He'll find that worry, stress, and hard-heartedness takes the place of that compassionate person who understood the need of others. Amen? He'll find one who depends upon his own wisdom rather than coming to God in prayer. He'll find one who depends upon the dedication of all that is around him to himself rather than fasting that he might become more like Christ. Amen? So there's a real complication in his life, isn't it? His master is the flesh. He has forsaken God as his supply. His treasures are that which are not laid up in heaven, but laid up in the world. His heart, mind, minds the things of the world. And he's a child of God. But in every aspect of life, he is without fellowship of God. Amen. Amen. Do you know the Bible says that God will never leave you nor forsake you? How do you balance those two thoughts with what I just said? Can I tell you this? If you're a believer, God never leaves you. God never lets you go to the side of the flesh, to leave the Spirit and go to the flesh, but that you choose to do so. He will not leave you, but you can leave Him. Amen. So then, as we come to this portion of Scripture, just these two verses tonight, and I'm just hoping I can get through these two verses. I've only got on two verses, folks. I've got, hold on, I'll tell you. I can't tell you. Can't get the pages apart. 5 pages of notes. But this is not just for you. When I'm putting these lessons together, I'm studying it. So I put together a lesson that I have studied out for me. And then I give you all that God will give me to give to you and all that time will allow. But I'm going to put this back and somewhere along the way, I'm going to come back and for my own study sake, I'm going to study this again and I'm going to have notes to build off of. Amen. So this is not just preparing for you. This is God teaching me as well. God instructing me way before He instructs you. Amen. Through me. Amen. So let's just begin then. This materialism, this attitude, this direction of path that a believer has taken, he is now going to be overtaken with himself. And the devil's going to encourage him every step of the way. He's going to tell that one who is looking toward the world, how pleasant are the plains over there. Remember Job? Lot. When he came up with his uncle Abraham and was so blessed and he became to be pretty self-sufficient. When he started out, everything that Abraham had, he blessed Lot with. And pretty soon we read that Lot had herdsmen and Lot had sheep and Lot had goats. And Lot said, hey, how come I'm not as good as Abraham? And they become crowded in the land until Abraham told Lot, we got to split up here, buddy. This is not spiritually good for either of us. And the Bible says that Lot looked on the plains and they were well watered. He looked at them not with a spiritual eye, but with an eye of the flesh. You remember Abraham? Abraham is the father of the children of God. Abraham is the one God called out of the air of the Chaldees. Abraham knows what it is to walk by faith and trust God. Lot knew what it was to walk with God and trust Abraham. There's a difference there, folks. And so this was Abraham's testimony. Lot, choose wherever you want to go. Wherever you want to go, I'll go the other way. Wherever you go, I'll go the other way, and God will still bless me. He's done it since I walked with him out of the air of the Chaldees. I trust God. Abraham trusted God, and Lot trusted the well-watered plains. Now, I have to tell you, in my opinion, I like to put that in there, according to the book of Hebrews, Lot knew God. The Bible says that when he was down in Sodom, that the wickedness of that city vexed Lot's soul. And God sent the angels down to get it, Lot out of that city. But if you accept that or not, doesn't matter. He made a choice. And he went the way of the flesh, while Abraham walked in the fellowship of God. That's the choice, isn't it? Amen. So when we see this self-righteousness, it brings a focus on wrong things. It brings a focus on the water, on the plains. Amen? The idea, listen to what he says here in verse 25. I'm sorry. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life. Now, most of us do not have any idea or any concept of what that means. I have to be honest with you that it didn't quite mean what I thought it did when I started studying this. This is what it means. Take no thought means not to worry, do not become stressed out, do not consider the outcome of making a wrong choice, because if you're walking in the Spirit, you can't make a wrong choice.
Amen.
Amen. Abraham said, whichever way I go, God goeth with me. Whichever way I go, I don't care if there's water. Did you know? I'm going to put words in Abraham's mouth. I don't care if there's water where I go. God can bring water out of a rock.
Amen.
Isn't that good? I like that. I told you, I got into this today. It means not to worry, not to be stressed, amen? To totally cast all your cares upon God and walk down the road that you've never walked before, whistling a tune, excited because God leads you. Isn't that awesome? I like that. Philippians 4 verse 6 counsels the believer to be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your needs be known. Somebody. To God. Amen? I like that myself. Jesus is not saying that a man ought not to prepare for his daily existence. We ought to do all that a man that is committed to God and is involved in following God ought to look at every day's life as a blessing from God, but a labor for that believer. In fact, the Bible said, I meant to put this in here. Let me back up and stick this in. God does not counsel us to be lazy. In fact, he says, if you don't work, you don't eat. Boy, wouldn't that put a lot of people out of the food line? Amen. I do believe in taking care of orphans and widows, folks. That's exactly what the Bible says we ought to do.
Amen.
But able-bodied men ought to work.
Amen.
I'm just saying. You say, well, preacher, you're old-fashioned. That's not how it works today. Yeah, and look where we are. Just saying. I got to quit saying that. Amen. He's not saying not to prepare for a day of living. Do all things for the glory of God. It's a different focus, a different attitude. The man that gets up in the flesh every morning, the carnal Christian gets up every morning looking at the water to see how many buckets of the water from the plains he can carry home and put in his well. The man who walks in fellowship with a God doesn't even look at the well. Amen? In all of the Bible, there's a lot of things I'd like to have seen. I could make you a list of them. And to be quite honest with you, my favorite miracle, I guess, the favorite power of God revealed in the Bible changes as I'm studying in that particular portion. It's kind of like what my favorite book of the Bible is. Do you have a favorite book of the Bible? You could put right across my chest Maytag, because I'm kind of wishy-washy. It's whatever book I'm studying is my favorite book. Amen? But one of my favorite things, would you not like to have stood with Israel after God brought them out, after they've seen the Red Sea part, and they've walked over and they're out in the middle of the wilderness, and you get up one morning and there's manna on the ground. Boy, wouldn't that be a socialist dream? Bread you didn't have to work for. Amen? We won't talk about the bread. It had a lot of restrictions on it. That would have been marvelous, wouldn't it? I'd like to have been there when the Red Sea parted. But walk with Israel now as they continue on in the wilderness area. Okay? They've come before going over in the promised land. God's turned them. They're in the wilderness. They're hungry. They give manna. And then they get thirsty because they're in a wilderness. You suppose they sent out scouts to see whether there's water or not? They've got conservatively a million people. Heard one guy say he thought it was closer to two. I don't care. It's a whole bunch of folk. You're not going to water those people out of a 55-gallon drum. Not even a teaspoonful each out of a 55-gallon drum. And who's going to carry it? You see what you see in the Bible? If you just stop and look at the circumstances that are there. Mothers are carrying their children that are thirsty. And there's nothing that can get as aggravated as a child can. And disrupt the tranquility of life as a child can. And so the elders, getting a little frustrated here, they come up to Moses and they say, you know what, Moses? We made a bad deal. This is what they're saying. We made a bad deal. We should have stayed in Egypt, because it would have been better for us to die there than to die here in this wilderness. They surely forget awfully quickly what Egypt was, didn't they? But this is the part I want you to see. Just picture this. Maybe just picture this as I would. I mean, you don't have to. Maybe my wife does not have a mind like mine. Amen. But I can see this. Moses, because this what Moses looks up to God and he says, God, what are we going to do? Listen, God said to Moses, watch this. He didn't, but that's how I picture it. He said, Moses, see that rock? How big you think that rock was? Now wait, the water that's going to come out of it is going to water a million people. If that rock is this big around, it's going to come out with so much pressure, it's going to be better than a fire hose. It's going to wash them all away. It's going to be and besides which, when the water starts running, how far is the distance you perceive that that many people would be standing waiting for water? How far out would they be? So how far is the water going to have to run from that thirsty man at the first to that thirsty man at the end? How long is it going to take? That guy out there may die of thirst waiting for the water. I'd like to have been there, because I'm kind of the opinion it was a pretty good sized rock. Amen. And it opened up and a flood of water came out in the middle of a desert. Amen. A river flowed. Now check this. And the rock went with them. Who carried it? A rock that big. Who carried it? Now, it might not have been a rock any bigger than this, and God just let that much water come out of it. I mean, He filled up a cruise that while you poured the oil out of it, never went dry. I mean, you understand? But in my mind, I like for it to fit. Who carried that rock? Listen to me. Who is the rock? The Lord carried that rock. Every morning they got up and the manna was on the ground. Who baked it? Who delivered it? Now just think about this. Every morning they saw God when they picked up the manna. In fact, Jesus said He was that manna. When the canteens were empty, the rock opened up and gave the water of life. Isn't that what Jesus said He was? I kind of got off course here just a little bit, but I like that so much. So Jesus is not saying don't prepare. In fact, every day that they got up when the manna was on the ground, He told them, go get the bread. Amen? Do you think Jesus couldn't have put the bread in their bread basket? Amen. He's talking about focusing on Him and not on the materialistic things of the world, and laboring by His grace and His supply, not to your own self-sufficiency. Amen. Oh, I missed the point. I got to back up. Hang on. Okay, here we are. Becoming a materialist forces you to become a hoarder, laying up for yourself, guarding what you have. I had a friend. I guess I still have him. I don't know if he's dead. And even if he's dead, I still have him. He was a believer. But we didn't exactly agree on everything. I'm a premillennialist. That's a lot of syllables. I'm a pre-tribulationist. I believe Jesus is going to come and catch away the church, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, before that man of sin is revealed. Now, you do understand that everybody don't believe that just because we do. There are people out there that are mid-tribulationists. There are people out there that are all millennialists. There are people out there that are post-tribulationists. All this has to do with when the Son of Man will come. I believe He's going to come before the tribulation. We're not appointed under wrath. Amen? God gave Noah a boat to put his family in to preserve them above the flood waters. Wasn't that Noah? Yes, Moses led them out of Egypt. He's given us an ark, who is Jesus Christ, that at the Lamb's Supper, that ark's going to lift us above the judgment, and we'll spend those 7 years of tribulation at the Lamb's Supper. But this man didn't believe that. He believed that we were going to go through the tribulation. He was a post-tribulationist. Amen? He believed that the believers, those who are born again, bought by the blood, we're going to go through the harshness and the hardness of the tribulation, which, number one, the church is not even appointed at that time. That's all about Israel. When you have a wrong focus, you must prepare even for that wrong focus. And I will give this man credit. He believed it. He took me one day and showed me his house. He and his family had built an underground house. And with all the technology that was at his disposal, and he was quite a sharp man, he had dug a hole and put his house in it and buried it and faced the entrance toward this wall here, and it just, as you're driving up to it, just looked like a hill. I can't tell you. It was very self-sustaining. That's as far as I can go. I'd take time to describe it, but I'm already out of time. And he said this, because he asked me what I was. I told him I'm a pre-tribulationist. And boy, did we have some discussions from there. And then I found out I better go back and find out why I believe what I believe. And I spent about 3 weeks going back and studying some college courses that all I did was get through them. But he had made preparation to preserve himself and his family. Himself. Not depending on God as Noah did. Amen. but himself. He had this place built. He had it stocked. He had it a hole dug down in the ground down to a level where he had a thermostat in it where he could keep meat. He had a well in there with a pump on it. He was ready for 7 years of tribulation. And I said, "You've got one problem, Brother King." He said, "What's that?" I said, "I know where it's at. You lay up your treasures on earth and somebody's going to break in and steal them. And if we go through the tribulation, I'm going to step there and say, 'I believe I was wrong, Mr. King. You were right. We're going through the tribulation. You better share with me because I'm coming with my guns.'" Now, listen to me. When you're a materialistic person, you must serve that materialism. It becomes your God. I don't know if he's still got the house or not, but I bet he's had to change all the supplies. Self-sufficiency focuses on us on a worldly walk and depends on us. The Bible says, "Casting all your cares upon him that careth for your soul." Who do you cast your cares on when your focus is nothing but worldly? Just you. Amen. And then you have to become, as we were just talking, afraid of somebody stealing it. I lay my treasures up in heaven. You can't steal it. Amen. But I have found out they can steal it here, no matter how hard you try to keep them from doing it. Some fool will figure out how to do it. Amen? I told you this a couple weeks ago. I've been hacked 2 or 3 times. Got hacked here just recently. Cost me $108. I just happened to be looking at my online banking when a 99-cent charge hit it. And I said, "Uh-oh." So I went right straight to the bank and we got it stopped. And right after the 99-cent one came a 90-some-odd dollar one. Cost me $108, $99 or something like that. I don't remember. But here's what happened. I asked Miss Mask. No, it wasn't Miss Mask. It was that lady I was talking to there. I said, "Do you not do anything to stop this? I've been hacked in this bank 3 times. What are you doing to stop, to protect my stuff? I could do better protecting my stuff if I put it in my garage and stood on it with a gun. I could protect it myself." I've tried that. That don't work either. This is what she said. "We've done everything we can. We try to stay on top of every new thing out there that will allow them to get into these accounts. We've done everything we can. And when you've done everything you can, somebody will break in and steal it." And God said, "Go ahead. Put it in the worldly stuff and see how long you keep it." Here's another problem. This is not in my message. This is free. I just thought of it. When you die, you don't even get to take it with you. If you're a believer, you're still going to heaven. But everything you focused on, you don't get to take it. Me neither. But you recall, the Pharaohs thought they were going to take it with them. And they buried it. And they were so dead set on nobody knowing where it was that the servants that helped to bury him, they killed him and left him in the tomb with him. I always wondered who it was that killed the ones that were supposed to die with him. Who was going to kill them and the ones after them? Somebody knew where it was. And if that didn't do it, sometime later some fool came along and said, "Anybody that breaks in here, you're going to be haunted by a mummy." And they broke in anyway and took all the treasure. And mummies, by the way, that chase you at night are only in Hollywood. You got a wrong focus. You've got to serve your focus. We walk in self-sufficiency, and we have declared that we do not trust God to care for us nor supply for our need. Amen? Philippians 4:19 says, "I can do all things through Christ that strengtheneth me." But the focus of a materialistic believer is, "I can do all things through myself that strengtheneth me." You see what's happened to the fellowship of the believer in Jesus? They've been separate. You can't hold on to two masters. Either you'll love the one and hate the other. Amen. And by the way, somebody said, well, which one do you suppose he was loving and which one you was hating? Whichever one he was serving. If he was serving the flesh, he was hating God and loving the flesh. If he was serving God, he was hating the flesh and loving God. Who is your master? Who you serve is where your heart will be. When you walk in self-sufficiency, you walk with a focus on the things of the world, food and drink, basically. Food, drink, clothing, but the things that the world can give you. Matthew chapter 4, verses 4. Oh, by the way, let me say one more thing before I go to Matthew 4. There's nothing wrong with having the things of the world. God gave the world and the creation to Adam and Eve that they could live thereby, that they could go out and take from the world all that was necessary for their life, but they could not forget to thank God for it. Matthew chapter 4, verses 4 is in the Mount of Temptation where Jesus has gone up onto the mountain. The devil is speaking to him, and Jesus makes this statement, man doth not live by bread alone. Doesn't say man doesn't live by bread. He said it cannot be alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Amen? When we walk in this self-sufficiency, we walk not in the Word of God. Amen? Bread is important, but it's not the end result of all things. The basic problem with man is setting priorities in his life that have to do with seeking God's will before he seeks the worldly things. Listen to what it says in verse 33. You all know this verse. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. God said, you walk as Abraham said, go whichever way you want to, Joe or your lot. Take that plains that's well watered. I don't care what it looks like. If you want to go the other way, if you want to go over to the north, I'll go to the south. If you want to go east, I'll go west. I'm walking with the Lord and God will supply for me. And Lot said, I got to go where I can see what's in line for me. Got to see it. And this is what Abraham was saying, folks. It's in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. I'll walk with God, and He'll bring the water, and He'll bring the manna, and He'll bring whatever is necessary for me, and I will prosper in the things of the world, and I will give God thanks for it. Amen. Hey! Okay. Self-sufficiency lose sight of God's love and supply for us as believers. Lose sight of it. Look at verse 26. Behold the fowls of the air. Now, the Lord is teaching here. He's teaching them to consider God's handiwork and to see if God's come short in grace to any living thing. Remember, the Bible says, doth not even nature declare that God is? So he's taking a point out of nature and he says, look at the birds. They don't work. I don't know if you could ask a bird that if he thought that. Because I've watched them almost every year on my back porch. I don't know what they are, but they labor every year. I take it down every fall. They put it back every spring. A nest where they put eggs in it. And I'm telling you, they labor. Two birds will labor and labor and labor to gather everything. And they'll build a nest and it'll come up and they'll put two little birds in it. And when the birds fly off, they do too. And I'm assuming if I didn't take the nest down, next year they'll come back and use it again. Amen? But this is what the Lord said. A bird doesn't think one thing about what he's going to eat, what he's going to wear. God made birds so, and I'm going to help you ladies with this. God made birds so beautiful that just looking at them is exciting. You ever seen a pheasant in the field? A male, what do they call them? The male? Rooster? Is that what it is? Okay. They're pretty, aren't they? Boy, they're pretty. My brother-in-law was a pheasant hunter, went up into western Kansas, had them mounted on logs standing there. Beautiful birds. Hang on, ladies. Best looking gender is always the male. Just to let you know. But do you know why? Do you know why? Think about it for a moment. Do you know why? Because God said to Adam, it's not good that man be alone. And that rule goes all the way through the creation of God. And man, or the male species, is always looking for a hen, always looking for the female. And he's got to get her attention because she's the one that's going to raise the kids. She's the one that's going to give consent to the family. Look at my feathers. And she says, so what? Look at that one there. Just telling you. Thought I'd help you out, ladies, so you'll know. Amen. Just go to a high school somewhere and watch. Watch these little boys as they strut. They're trying to impress that hen. Amen. Just saying. God knows what he's doing. This sufficiency loses sight of God's supply in the believer's life. And we start to look around to see what's out there that might serve me better than what God gives. And this is what he says in verse 26. Why will you do that? Because does not God know what you need, just like he knows what the bird needs? And are you not better than a bird? Now let me give you an answer to that. Yes. You're better than the bird. You're better than your cat. You're better than your puppy. You're better than your herd of cows. You're better than any other thing in the creation, no matter what it is. We are the top of the food chain, not because we evolved there, but because God put us there. Amen. And he says, aren't you better than all these things? Why are you trying to get all this stuff for yourself? Don't you know I take care of everything in creation? I can take care of you. Amen. But materialism turns to self-sufficiency, which turns us to a miserable life. We spend our life in worry, in distress, in lack of peace. We lose the peace of God in our life, and everything is a struggle to try to keep what we've got. And sooner or later, the undertaker is going to tap you on the chest and say, say, buddy, you're dead. What do you got now? Well, if you're saved, you'll have heaven. Amen. But I want to walk over where my name's on that vault and open the door and see a whole bunch of stuff. Treasures I've laid up in heaven. You say, that's... And by the way, when you get to heaven, what do you want it for? You're walking on streets of gold. God's already prepared a mansion. He's already given you eternal life, and you're going to live there in the very presence of God and in the rulership of God, and everything's going to be like it was in the Garden of Adam, in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, where there is no sin, except one thing's going to be better. You won't be restricted to this mud ball we call the earth. When they open that vault, I want it to be just like Scrooge, the duck. I want to be able to sit in the middle of it and throw it up in the air and let it fall down over me. I want to back up with some about 8 or 10, 15, 20, 30 of these gravel trucks and fill them up and run them out one after another. I sat over here at 380 the other day and saw 14 trucks turning to the right. I count trucks just to see how many I can get in a group. And someone says, well, isn't that selfish? Yep. Because when I get over to Revelation, it says I'm going to take all those treasures. Because I can't buy a stinking thing in heaven with them. Amen? It's whatever socialist wants. It's all free. And we all get it. Amen? I'm going to take those trucks and I'm going to drive them right in front of the throne of God. And I'm going to hit that switch and let them out the bottom. Those bottom dumps, those whatever they call them, bottom things, whatever. And then I'm going to come over and bow down before the Lord. And I'm saying, God, take all of this as a testimony that in my life, I lived those up to now, 75 years, as a testimony that for 40 of them, I loved you and labored for your glory. That's the only purpose for that treasures in heaven. You think, boy, I'm going to have treasure in heaven. I'm going to have me a wad of $100 bills in my pocket. What would you do with them? Like that story about that rich guy that died and however it worked out. When he died, an angel came along and said, you know what? We've made an exception for you. You can take everything you got and we're going to convert it into gold value. And you can take it with you in two sacks. So he got to heaven and got to heaven's door, and St. Peter, you know, it doesn't happen this way. But St. Peter was there and he said, told him who he was, and he says, well, open the gates, and said, come on in. And he turned around and cried out or hollered out toward the throne of God, and he says, say, we got a guy here with two bags of pavement. I guess you'll get that tomorrow. Has no value there, folks, other than a testimony of your being here and glorifying God with your life. Next week, we're going to start in verse 27. We didn't get too far, which says, which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Man labors and labors and labors to establish his glory in the world to the degree that he can. And God said, one thing, one of the least of all things that my hand created, a lily, has more glory than a man can put together in a lifetime. Amen. Why then do we walk in self-sufficiency when we ought to be walking in the sufficiency of God? Stand with me if you would. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we thank you for the day you've given us, God, and for these scriptures that we can study. Lord, not just study, but be encouraged by, be taught by, and to a great degree often, Lord, to be corrected by when we get our attention on the wrong things. Lord, help us that we might always walk, that you may be glorified through our life. We might always walk depending upon you, not on ourself. Not becoming materialistic, but Lord, understanding that the world is here for our success and for our living, and using it, Lord, as you would have, but remembering to always give you thanks for that which you give to us. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.